really excited tonight. Tonight is special. It's a special night, not just for me, but I believe for you too. In particular, I have the honor to introduce our guest speaker tonight. He was my strategic advisor during the PhD program, and he was also my mentor during PhD years at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. The title of his talk tonight is The Global Financial Crisis, Causes, Bailout, and Future. He explored the causes of the global financial crisis that began in 2007, the U.S. government bailout of the global financial system, why it made things worse, and its policy implications. He's a professor of economics at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, and director of research at the Center for Full Employment and Price Stability. He has recently written a series of policy notes and public policy briefs for the AV Institute. Some of my students might be familiar with that material, assessing the role of that managed money played in creating the current crisis and developing policy reforms to promote a more stable financial sector. So please welcome senior scholar Randall Way.
Well, thank you. This actually is the second time that I've been here giving a talk, but Bill Waller informed me that most of you weren't born the last time around, so you will not remember that. So I'll try to go slow. I know that we have a mixture of backgrounds in the audience, and there might be some things that I need to explain, and I'm happy to slow down even more if necessary. First, I'm going to spend most of the time talking about the causes of the crisis. So this is just an outline of that part of the talk, but it's going to be the majority of the talk. So first we'll talk a little bit about the Minsky moment, which is the way most people describe the crisis when it first hit. Then take a look at what I think is a much more fruitful way of looking at the crisis, that is in terms of Minsky's stages approach. Talk a little bit about the financialization and layering of debt on debt that led up to the crisis. In addition, the shredding of the reforms we got the last time that we had a Great Depression with a debt deflation. We essentially got rid of most of the reforms, and that contributed to the problems that we saw leading up to the crisis. And then look in more detail at the immediate precursors to the crisis. This was the Goldilocks years of President Clinton. And then finally, the role that fraud played in the real estate bubble. Not included on this outline, I will briefly talk about the bailout. I can go into that in more detail if anyone wants to hear that in the Q&A. And then finally, where we might be heading. So first, Hyman Minsky was my dissertation advisor, and he's very famous for developing this financial instability hypothesis. And I don't have time to go into it in detail. Probably many of you are going to be introduced to Minsky during the course of your studies here. But basically, he was adding financial instability to Keynes's theory that was presented in the general theory. So Minsky always argued that what he was presenting was an investment theory of the cycle. Okay, that's clearly the Keynesian view. The cycle is driven by investment growing and then finally investment declining. And with a multiplier, that gives us the business cycle. But what was left out of the general theory was the financial theory of investment. This is what Minsky is adding to Keynes's general theory, to argue that financial fragility makes this cycle much worse and opens up the possibility of what he called a debt deflation process like we had during the Great Depression. So very quickly, the idea is that over the course of the business cycle, you move from what he called hedge finance. Don't mistake this with hedge funds. That's a completely different idea. Hedge finance is just a very safe form of finance. It's where your income flows are expected to meet all of your payment commitments. Okay? It's safe. You got a margin for error in case something goes wrong. to a speculative position, and this is one where you can cover your interest payments, but in the near term, your income flows are not enough to actually repay the loan. A little bit riskier because it requires that you are able to get finance as you need it. You can roll over your finance, you can make all your interest payments, but the banks have to be willing to go along with you, okay? And then finally, Ponzi finance. Ponzi finance was named after a guy named Charles Ponzi, who, if I remember right, was in Boston, and he ran a pyramid scheme. Think Bernie Madoff, it's exactly the same idea. If Ponzi hadn't been alive, we'd be calling it the Madoff part of the transition from speculative finance to Ponzi. In Ponzi finance, you can't even make the interest payments. So you actually have to borrow to pay interest. That's called capitalizing your interest. Obviously, that's pretty dangerous. Something is going to have to change, or you are going to go bankrupt. The bank will eventually stop lending to you because you can't even pay the interest, okay? So the idea is, over the course of a business cycle, in the beginning, almost everybody's hedged. Gradually, you get some economic units. He's focusing mostly on firms, but households could do this too. Start engaging in speculative finance, and then finally, you get a bunch of Ponzi finance, and the whole thing can collapse. When it does collapse into a financial crisis in the post-war period, we have the big government and the big bank to bail them out. The big government is the Treasury. The idea here is that when the economy turns down, the government budget moves toward a deficit. And I know that in the United States we have all this deficit hysteria, but in Minsky's view, a budget deficit in a downturn would help put a floor to aggregate demand. So unemployment didn't rise too high, profits didn't fall too low, the economy could gradually recover with a big budget deficit. And the big bank is the Fed. The Fed can intervene and act as a lender of last resort to prevent a run on banks like we had in the 1930s, which would lead to an ever-cascading run on financial institutions and causing a liquidity crisis and eventually a solvency crisis. So with the big government and the big bank rescuing the financial system every time we had a financial crisis, we could prevent it. It is the Great Depression from happening again. He had a book in 1982 with that title. Okay, so that was the idea. The problem is stability is destabilizing. Okay, you think about this. If we have a stable economy, it encourages this transformation from hedge to speculative Ponzi. Okay, because you think the economy is very stable, so you don't have to worry that much about taking a lot of risk. And then when things go bad, the government bails you out. That will change the way you behave. You start to figure that no matter what goes wrong, it doesn't matter, Uncle Sam is standing there and is going to bail me out. So it changes your behavior in a way that makes things ever more risky and makes financial crises ever more certain to happen. Okay? He developed this theory in the late 1950s. We went from World War II to 1966 with no financial crises. The longest period the U.S. had ever gone without a financial crisis. So he's developing this theory when we have no financial crises. He was looking forward to the future. He could see what was going to happen. Okay, so he was projecting the way that the economy was going to change. Financial crises would start occurring. And they did, 1966, 1970, 1974, okay? So these crises start occurring. They start occurring more frequently, and each one is more severe and takes a bigger intervention by the government to save the financial sector. I just focused on the ones since 1980. These are much bigger than the previous ones. In the 1980s, we had the thrift crisis. This was mostly a problem in commercial loans. We had a bubble in commercial real estate and lots of fraud. That led to a crisis that required a big intervention by the government. Finally, this was resolved at the end of the 80s into the early 90s with a bailout of the thrift sector that cost about $200 billion. Okay? Bill Black, who I understand a lot of you have heard his name, was the guy who blew the whistle on Charles Keating, the worst of the fraudsters that had helped to create this crisis, and he helped to resolve the problem. Also in the 80s, we had the LDC, we used to call them less developed countries, now we call them developing countries, it sounds more hopeful. We had a developing country debt crisis that almost brought down the biggest US banks. And so we also had to deal with that. Also in the 80s, we had Michael Milken, and maybe only the older people here will remember Michael Milken, and the leveraged buyout boom, okay? So we had those crises in the 1980s. In the 1990s, we had the new economy. Now we're finally getting to more recent history. Maybe some of you can remember the dot-com boom, pets.com, and all that stuff. Mostly in NASDAQ, but the rest of the stock market also boomed. Greenspan warned in 1996 of irrational exuberance. The markets did not like him talking that way, so he didn't do it again. In any event, at the end of the 90s, that whole thing collapsed and we went into a recession. We got out of the recession with a residential real estate boom, and that was based mostly on subprimes and Alt-A's, fairly risky mortgages, and now we've got the foreclosure problems. And finally, in the 2000s, we had the commodity markets bubble, which ended in 2008 and then resumed again, and you notice the effect at the gas pump every time you fill up your car. We're back into the commodities bubble. Anyway, each of these sort of follows the pattern that I just laid out, the financial instability hypothesis, and each crisis is worse than the previous one. Each one is bailed out by the government. It takes a bigger and bigger bailout in order to accomplish that. Just one note. When Minsky was developing this theory in the 50s, the focus was on investment by firms. If you look at this list here, these crises were not investment crises. They were not caused by investment in plant and equipment, real estate crises, commodities crises, and consumer debt crises and so on. So Minsky started adapting his theory as he went along. Okay? 1950s were different than the 1980s. And in the 1980s, he started changing the way that he looked at the transformation of the economy. He started taking a much longer term view of the transformation of the economy over time. And this is what I refer to as the stages approach. So when this crisis hit in 2007, you started having analysts, including reporters, calling it the Minsky moment or the Minsky crisis. And they were looking at it in the way that I just described, that it's a short-term process, a cyclical process. But I immediately started writing about it as, no, this is the stages approach is the correct way to look at this. It's a long-term transformation of the economy. Now, I don't have time to go through every one of these stages in detail, so I'm just gonna hit high points on the previous ones. Back in the 1900s, we had what Minsky called the commercial capitalism stage. And you can think of this as an economy in which commercial banks are the most important part of the financial system. What a commercial bank does is it makes a short-term loan to firms to finance their wage bill and raw materials costs. Okay, it's a short-term loan. By the end of the 1900s, investment in plant and equipment had become so expensive because we now had complex capital equipment. We had huge factories. We had railroads that firms needed long-term finance. So this was the age of investment banking. Investment banks provide long-term funding for positions in expensive, long-lived, usually very complex capital assets, okay? So we had the stage of finance capitalism. The Minsky didn't actually come up with this term. It's Rudolf Hilferding wrote about the rise of finance capitalism. Maybe some of you have read Veblen. Veblen also wrote about this stage of capitalism in his theory of business enterprise. So, and Keynes also recognized this transformation of the economy. You get a bit of that in chapter 12 of the general theory. So this is the rise of Goldman Sachs and other investment banks. Okay, in Minsky's view, that form of capitalism failed. It crashed in 1929. So the Great Depression was the end of finance capitalism, and it was caused by investment banks, by overextension of finance by investment banks. We collapse. Half of all the banks fail. Government had to nationalize 75% of the remaining banks. We implemented all the New Deal reforms that heavily constrained financial institutions, separated investment banking from commercial banking in the Glass-Steagall Act, and on and on and on. Lots of regulations on the financial sector. We come out of World War II with what he called paternalistic welfare state capitalism, a different form of capitalism. Not only with the constraints on the financial sector, but also with a big government. The government in 1929, federal government, was only 3% of GDP in 1929. Come out of World War II, and the federal government stays about 25% of GDP. Okay, so a very much bigger government, with a Fed that was responsible for financial stability, which had not been responsible for previous to the Great Depression. And finally, with all of the New Deal programs, like Social Security, that put a floor under aggregate demand, a social safety net. So we have all those things. And a much more stable form of capitalism. We go through a period, as I already said, with no financial crises for 20 years. Also, the most rapid growth the U.S. had ever seen. It's called the golden age of U.S. capitalism, and so on. But over time, stability is destabilizing. Over time, risk-taking grows because we have no financial crises. It doesn't seem risky to take risk. There have been no financial crises. People's memories of the Great Depression fade away. Okay? You start, you no longer take into account the possibility that we can have deep recessions. It seems like the big government and the big bank are there to make sure nothing bad ever happens. And so risk-taking grows on trend. At the same time, another aspect of money manager capitalism is that with all of these New Deal reforms and the creation of the safety net and protection for labor unions and what John Kenneth Galbraith wrote about the new industrial state, this cooperation of big union, big labor, big government leads to a growing economy, but also to growing saving. Okay, workers got pension funds, for example. We have the growth of tax-advantaged savings accounts, people saving for their retirements. All of this money had to be managed by professionals. So this is why Minsky calls it the age of money manager capitalism. You have the rise of money management. Huge pools of funds in search of high returns. Okay? Now Minsky's not the only one to notice this transformation of the economy. It goes by other names. Jamie Galbraith called it the predator state. Many people call it financialization, and that gets to a big aspect of this stage, as I'll get to in a second. George Bush called it the ownership society. We're all becoming owners of wealth. Okay, I'll come back to that. Neoliberalism or neoconservatism also gets to something there. And finally, Paul McCulley, who used to run PIMCO, called it the rise of shadow banking, which also gets to an aspect of it. In any event, many people saw this, but I don't think anyone really understood the implications of this better than Hyman Minsky. So here's the idea. Stability bred instability, more risk-taking, greater innovations that stretch liquidity, the accumulation of financial assets. Of course, the other side of the coin of a financial asset is there's a financial liability. For every financial asset, somebody owes. Globalization and securitization, these things actually go hand in glove. It is securitization that allowed globalization of finance. Often I ask my students, which were the first two banks to get in trouble because of American subprime mortgage lending? And most don't know. It was two German banks. Okay. The Central Bank of China has lots of these securitized mortgages. Everybody got them. They're all over the world. So securitization made it possible for even the Bank of China to have a piece of American real estate in the form of the debt against the homes. Okay? And then finally, self-supervision. A lot of people talk about deregulation. We deregulated financial sector. Well, that's true, but actually we took it a step further. We said, you know, what you guys are doing at places like Goldman Sachs is just too complicated. We can't possibly regulate you or supervise you. You're smarter than we are. Why don't you supervise yourself? And if things go bad, why don't you punish yourself too? We not only moved to self-supervision, we took it a step further. If you do something wrong, please punish yourself, okay? So it's self-punishment also. I'll just give a little bit of data to back up what I'm talking about, this transformation of money manager capitalism. So here is a picture that shows the share of financial institutions, the percent of total assets. And if we go back to World War II, you can see commercial banking was 60% of the economy. This is important because commercial banks were the most heavily regulated part of the financial sector. And they have access to the Fed. If anything goes wrong, they have a liquidity problem, they can borrow from the Fed. And they've got FDIC standing behind them. So a large part of their liabilities are insured by the government. Okay? They're heavily restricted, and if anything goes bad, Uncle Sam is right there. So that was a very safe financial system. You can see how much they decline as a percent of the financial sector. They become relatively unimportant. At the same time, we see the rise of managed money. This is stuff like pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, university endowments. I imagine you've got a big one here. So private colleges, university endowments, things like that. And the savings of Americans who are saving for their retirement. So that's all in here. All of this money is under professional management. Okay. Here's just a picture of US pension funds. You can see the growth of pension funds after World War II. There was sort of this grand bargain made among the government, unions, and their employers to build up pension funds to take care of workers' retirements. If you add these together at the peak, before the dot-com bust, that equals 75% of GDP. It's a huge amount of money under professional management, following the latest fads and fancies. Okay? So you have professionals who are always inducing them to put their money into whatever scheme they've got. Okay? And gradually over time, we broadened what pension funds were allowed to do until basically, after 1999, we told them, not only can you go into almost anything, you actually have to do that. Okay? You actually have to go into things like commodities futures. Right? Not only do we have growing wealth, of course, we also have growing debt. It's the other side of the coin. Here is a picture showing government debt plus private sector debt as a percent of GDP. That's a good way to measure how big the debt is. You can see that in around 1930, we go to a peak of 3 times GDP. That means we have $3 of debt for every dollar of GDP to service it. Okay? We collapse into the Great Depression. A lot of that debt goes bad. With a bankruptcy, the debt disappears. The economy starts growing in World War II, so the private sector debt ratio declined tremendously. The government sector debt ratio increased a lot because of World War II. As we go forward, we see the government's debt ratio declining a lot in the post-war period. This is not because the war debt ever got repaid. It's still out there. Almost all of it is still out there. It was never repaid. It's that GDP grew so rapidly that the debt ratio went down. Okay? We see the private sector debt ratio rising on trend. At first, it's rising fairly slowly. But you can see after about 1990, it really takes off. That is largely real estate debt, but there also is student loan debt. There's also credit card debt and other kinds of consumer loans. So that grows until it's 5 times GDP. So we greatly exceeded our previous peak. We've got $5 of debt for every dollar of income to service it, and most of that is private sector. There's a little band in there, GSE, that's government-sponsored enterprises, that's Fannie and Freddie, okay, which have been in the news quite a bit. In any case, most of it is private sector debt, as you can see. Now, while we have this growth of consumer debt, real estate debt, and some growth of government debt, a lot of the debt actually is financial institutions owing other financial institutions. That is layering of debt on debt. We'll come back to that in a second. We have a rising share of corporate profits going to the financial sector rather than to manufacturing and other corporations. We have an increasing use of very short-term debt. Up through 2007, it was very common for financial institutions to finance their positions and assets by issuing essentially overnight debt, so that every morning they would have to refinance $1 billion in short-term commercial paper. Okay. In 2007, that started to become a problem. And finally, something like casino speculation in things like commodities. Let me give a little bit of evidence of this. On this picture, the blue line shows the share of corporate profits going to the financial sector. The red line shows value added as a percent of GDP. You can see that they were both about 12% in 1955. And then value added doubles to 20%, a bit over 20%. So the financial sector became a fifth of our whole economy. All right? The financial sector is an intermediate good. An intermediate good became 20% of our economy. As a share of corporate profits, it quadrupled to 40% of GDP. This picture ends when the crisis hit. The financial sector is again getting 40% of all corporate profits now. Okay, so it has completely recovered back to its previous state of dominating the corporate sector in terms of its share of profit. Here is another picture. This is going back to the previous one, except dividing it so that you can see which parts of the private sector really expanded their debt. And there are two things that stand out in the picture. One is households' debt increased. Okay, so I already showed you the private sector debt ratio increased a lot. The household sector accounted for a much bigger part of that growth than the business sector of the economy. So the household sector at the peak had debt equal to about 125% of GDP. Okay. The other part of the private sector that grew a lot was the financial sector. So you can see the private finance growing from essentially zero to 125% of GDP. This is banks owing other banks. Financial institutions owing other financial institutions. This is what we mean by layering debt on debt. Financial institutions issuing debt to another financial institution so that they can buy a financial asset, rather than issuing insured liabilities to the household sector, for example, which is what traditionally commercial banks did. So this is much riskier. The reason is because it's short-term debt, it's not insured, and as I already described, the way that an overnight loan works, you got to refinance your position every time it comes due. And that requires that the financial institutions trust each other. Beginning in 2008, they lost all trust. And the reason was because you had a bank sitting here starting to look at their own portfolio, and they're saying, uh-oh, a lot of our assets are going bad. And they say, I wonder if other financial institutions have balance sheets as bad as ours. And they say, we better presume they've been doing exactly the same thing we've been doing, junk mortgages. Yeah, they're probably in just as bad a shape as we are. We're not going to accept their debt anymore. That's when the whole financial system stopped. Okay? So that's why that stuff is important. No economist was paying attention to this. Okay, I can remember Jane DeRista at UMass Boston started talking about this a decade ago. And everybody looked at her like she's out of her mind and said, it all nets to zero. It's all within the banking sector. Who cares? How could anything go wrong? Well, it goes wrong when they stop trusting each other. Okay, that is what really led to the financial crisis. Just another piece of evidence. You all know this quote from Keynes. When speculation dominates enterprise, the job is likely to be ill-done. Okay, if we go back before the Great Depression, before the 1929 stock market crash, the holding period of an average stock had declined to a year. The average stock was only held a year. Now you got to remember, lots of stocks are held by widows and orphans. They never trade them. I got my IBM stock, I'm never going to sell it, right? That's the attitude of the widow and orphan. To get the average down to one year, it means you have to have people that are buying and selling daily. Okay, of course, that's exactly what was going on. You can see that after 1929, the stock market changed. It goes up to 10 years. The average stock is held for 10 years. That is a long-term planning horizon. Okay, that gives firms the opportunity to also plan long-term. They can make long-term investments for the future. What happens after 1980? We get down below 1 year. No firm can afford to plan long-term because they got to watch their stock price. It becomes even worse because all of the top management are rewarded with stock options. They're going to get paid according to what the stock market does. Okay, they're all watching this. Everything becomes short-termism. So that's a big part of the problem. Okay, another aspect was the shedding of the New Deal reforms. I already talked about this. The move from deregulation and de-supervision to just self-supervision. This was promoted in the Basel agreements, Basel I and especially Basel II. Basel II said, you guys supervise yourselves, and I won't go into the complicated stuff, but they had incentives to buy these securities that I'll be talking about. Also to buy Greek government debt, because it had a zero risk rating. All sovereign government debt had a zero risk rating, and that's why you got so much Greek debt in French banks, because they didn't have to hold any capital against that stuff. Rising inequality and a falling wage share, I'll show a picture, probably all of you have seen this, and rising consumer debt, which compensated for that. So we had real wages didn't grow since 1974. But people wanted a rising living standard. They're all watching TV and seeing how people are supposed to live in America, and the only way to do that was to first have two income earners per household. Once you exhaust that, since you can't put little kids to work in America, they borrow. Okay? They borrow to finance their lifestyle. And so consumer debt grows. Here is wages and salaries as a percent of GDP. I could show you profits as a percent of GDP. Of course, it'll just be the mirror image. So profits are growing, wages are falling as a percent of GDP. So consumer debt growth was in part because wages were actually going down as a percent of GDP. Rick Wolf from UMass, Google it. You can watch his speeches on YouTube. They're excellent. This is the point that he talks about. So let's look at what happened in 2007. Why did the whole thing finally come apart? Because we're talking about a long-term trend. All the pictures I showed you show that this trend has been going on for a long time. The wage share has been going down. The debt ratio has been going up. Why did the economy pick 2007 to finally fall apart? Okay? So we need to explain that. go back to 1996, I realize that's prehistory for a lot of you. President Clinton, in 1996, the federal government started running a budget surplus for the first time since 1929. Does that year ring a bell? In fact, if you look back at U.S. history, before 1996, we had only had six periods in U.S. history where we had a budget surplus that lasted more than a quarter or two. A sustained budget surplus. It only happened six times in U.S. history. The last time was 1929, followed by the Great Depression. It turns out the five before that were also followed by our five other depressions. The correlation is 100%. Every time there's been a budget surplus, we had a depression. Every time, you can look it up, as Yogi Berra always said. Okay? Our seventh time was 1996. Clinton went on TV and said, we're going to have budget surplus for the next 15 years. We're going to retire all the outstanding government debt. Okay, you can go back, you can see he said this. We wrote about it at the Levy Institute at the time. We said, we are not going to run a budget surplus for 15 years. We're not going to retire the debt. We're going to have a deep recession and the budget deficit will return. Okay? Turned out we were right. In 2000, we went into a recession. The budget deficit returned, but what we didn't count on was the real estate bubble. Because the real estate bubble got the U.S. economy growing again. We got out of the Bush recession, and the budget surplus returned. So, the budget surplus didn't. The budget deficit reduced. Okay? So, I'll show you a picture in just a second. We had a budget surplus followed by a recession. Then the budget deficit declining, but over a 10-year period, we had the private sector running deficits, which had never happened before. I'll show you a picture in just a second. And private debt exploded. And the reason for that is there has to be a link at the macro level. If you think of an economy that only has two people, and I know we do this a lot in economics, Robinson Crusoe and Friday, the only way that Crusoe can spend more than his income is if Friday spends less than his. The deficits will exactly equal the surpluses in the aggregate. They have to balance to zero. Okay? So if we look at the private sector balance, the government sector balance, and the foreign balance, the sum of those has to be zero. This is day one, principles of economics. This is what you learn. Okay? But it's easier to see it here. Does anyone see a mirror image? There's a mirror image. The mirror image is right around zero. All the positives are offset by negatives. This has to be true or you made a mistake in your math. Okay? Because it's an identity. And what we see is normally the government, which is red, is below the line. The government taken as a whole runs a deficit. Almost all the time, as you can see. Okay? There is an exception. There is Clinton's proud moment. See where the red is above the line? That was our budget surplus. Okay? The blue is the private sector balance. You can see that the private sector almost always runs a surplus. That is, it saves, which makes sense. Households generally want to save. They're saving for the future. They're saving for their kids' college. They're saving for retirement. So normally the private sector runs a surplus above the line. Look at Clinton's proud moment, a budget surplus for the federal government. What happened to the private sector? A huge deficit. Look back in time. You can see little tiny ones that last for a quarter. Nothing like that had ever happened before, unless you go back to the 20s. The private sector, taken as a whole, for every dollar of income, the private sector was spending $1.06. All right? We go into the Bush recession, and you can see it goes above the line. People got scared. They started saving a little bit. They stopped spending as much. But then 2000, 2001, they started spending more than their income. So you can see we have a whole decade there where the private sector, except for the Bush recession, is spending more than its income. The last line I won't spend time on is the foreign balance. Okay, and the sum of the three has to equal zero, so it's sort of the offsetting account for the United States. It makes up the difference. If that were always zero, the government balance and the private sector balance would exactly offset each other. But in fact, we tend to, not tend to, we always run a trade deficit since Ronald Reagan days. We have a trade deficit, which means we have a positive capital account because it's the opposite of the current account. Anyway, that's the balancing item. Long story short, because we have a trade deficit, we actually must have a government budget deficit in order for our private sector to save. It's absolutely essential. So as we're running a $1 trillion budget deficit now, we can get private sector saving above the line with the capital account making up the difference between the two. Okay? In addition to this necessity that the private sector had to be running a deficit if the public sector was running a surplus, we had the growth of this belief that nothing can go wrong. When Greenspan was chairman of the Fed, in financial markets, they called it the Greenspan put. No matter what goes bad, we know Greenspan is going to lower interest rates and help out the financial sector, okay? When Bernanke came in, he wrote a famous paper, I believe it was 2004, called The Great Moderation. He announced that we had entered a period of the Great Moderation because central banks really know what they're doing now, so that we don't really need to worry anymore. We're not going to have any more recessions. Whenever an economist says something like this, you know what's going to happen. Samuelson said the same thing in the late 60s. Economists, now we understand the economy, we're going to fine-tune it, no more recessions. And of course, we started getting deep recessions right after he said it. Irving Fisher was very famous for announcing either September or early October 1929, the stock market has reached a permanent plateau. It's never going to go down. Collapsed in October 1929. So anyway, when you hear a prominent economist say something like this, that's the time to get really worried. So Greenspan says, no, don't worry. Both Greenspan and Bernanke denied that there were any bubbles. We had Fed researchers come to the Levy Institute in spring of 2007 saying they had looked at U.S. real estate and there are no real estate bubbles. The real estate price growth is due to fundamentals. That was their argument in 2007, just as we collapsed, okay? This is how good the Fed researchers are. So anyway, the reality is it was not driven by fundamentals. We were living through the biggest debt, the biggest equity, the biggest commodity markets, the biggest real estate bubbles in history. Not U.S. history, human history. These were the biggest bubbles in human history. You've all heard of tulip bulb mania. That's nothing compared to our commodities market bubble. That was one commodity. Tulip bulbs. Ours is across 25 commodities. They are three standard deviations away from the mean. Three standard deviations, 25 commodities. Okay. Nothing like this has ever happened before. These are the biggest bubbles humans have ever seen. We're living in them. We've become the bubblicious economy, or Babylonia. This is what was discovered under Clinton. This is the only thing we've got going on. So what we do is we stoke bubbles because that keeps the economy growing a little bit. At least Wall Street does okay. So, Babylonia. And then when things go bad, what happens? The government steps in and bails them out. Okay, so that has been the pattern, that is the expectation. And the problem with that is, you know, not only does it encourage ever more risk, but you never clean the system out. The good thing about Great Depressions, if there's one good thing about the Great Depression, the good thing is it clears out the debt. You get to start over again without the debt. our financial crises always wipe out a little bit of debt, but not enough. We start again already with a heavy debt load. I'll talk a little bit about the innovations that helped to bring on the 2007 crisis. So securitization was a big part of this story. Hyman Minsky actually wrote a paper that he gave out to his money and banking class in 1987, saying, that which can be securitized will be securitized. Everything will get securitized. He said this in 1987, and what happened? Everything got securitized. Okay, student loans, securitized. Credit card debt, securitized. Even the leases for cars, securitized. They're securitizing death settlements. Okay? They're securitizing life insurance policies. Everything is securitized now. The basic idea is you pool a bunch of debt, for example, mortgages, to act as the collateral for securities. Now, this had been going on, Minsky's writing about it in 1987, but it really exploded beginning in the late 1990s. Why was that? Because there wasn't enough treasury debt. Why wasn't there enough treasury debt? Because the government is starting running a budget surplus. It wasn't issuing any more debt. Okay? In fact, the Fed started holding conferences in the late 1990s. What are we going to do when there's no more government debt out there? Because they took Clinton seriously, okay? But financial markets took that seriously too. What do you mean there's not going to be any government debt out there? They use government debt as the collateral. Remember, I already said they're borrowing from other financial institutions. They have to have collateral to borrow. What do they use as collateral? Federal government debt. It's riskless. So you could go borrow almost 100 cents on the dollar against government debt. So they needed something that had a rating almost as good as US Treasuries. So the idea was you could get securities of home mortgages and those would be rated almost as good as Treasury. The reason is because Americans almost never default on home mortgages. Okay? Americans like their homes, they'll do anything to make their house payment. So that had always been the history. The default rate is extremely low. So they started securitizing mortgages. In the beginning, that was fine, because home mortgages are very safe. The problem was, there wasn't enough of it. They needed more collateral. So they said, well, why don't we securitize some mortgages that aren't quite as good? And what we can do is we can tranche it. We can divide it up so that you can buy a AAA rated tranche. This is just as good as treasuries. And then we'll have a B and a C and so on down to junk bond status. The idea is whatever mortgage payments get made, they go to the AAA part first. So it actually doesn't matter if we make safe mortgage loans because we can get a AAA tranche no matter how risky the mortgages are. Because the first payments will always go there, and not everybody's going to default at the same time, so it looks like this is going to be a really safe thing to do. But once you've decided that it doesn't really matter if you make risky loans, the underwriting standards decline, especially when Wall Street can't get enough of this stuff. They're always pressuring the mortgage brokers, come on, we need more mortgages, please go out and make more mortgages. They had to lower their standards in order to make enough mortgages, and then they had to get into the second mortgages on houses, which was almost 50% of all the junk. Subprime mortgages actually were not to buy a house. It was refinancing a house or borrowing against the house to buy a new car and all that sort of stuff. So anyway, we gradually move from low doc, so you're missing one document when you go in to get a mortgage, to no documents. No, we don't need to see your W-2 forms. We don't need any evidence that you're actually employed. To advertising ninja loans. No income, no job, no assets, no problem. Come in, we'll give you a home mortgage loan. Okay, so they actually advertise these things. You could say it's don't ask, don't tell. The reason why they wanted to do this is that they didn't want it to come back that they had made mortgages knowing that you couldn't possibly make the payments on the mortgages. So please don't give us any documentation. We're not going to ask you for it. We don't care whether you have a job. We're not going to ask about that stuff. We'll make a home mortgage loan. Anyway, if you go back to It's a Wonderful Life, I suppose everybody has seen that. So Jimmy Stewart's thrift, you had a loan officer, you had a bank teller, you had a home appraiser to make sure that the home's value was as higher than the mortgage you're going to get, and then you recorded it all with the public recorder. Okay? The loans were held to maturity. There was a great incentive to do good underwriting, to make sure that the people getting the mortgage actually were going to make the payments to you, the thrift or bank, because you're holding their mortgage. We moved into a supposedly more efficient model that requires a broker, okay, mortgage broker, not going to be the lender, it's the one who comes to the house, probably works out of his basement, who gets you to sign the documents in order to get the mortgage. An appraiser, a lender, a servicer, MERS, which was created to get around the county recorders, the credit rater, the securitizer, credit rater, rocket scientist, literally, that's who went to Wall Street to create the models that determine the risk on the stuff, the mortgage-backed security trustee, CDOs, collateralized debt obligations that are sort of synthetic securities, squared and cubed, that is, CDOs of CDOs of CDOs, that's cubed, credit default swaps and monolines to insure the stuff, investors, traders, accountants, lawyers, lender processing services, because we separate who you pay your mortgage payment to from the bank that made the loan. Robo-signers, when you find out, uh-oh, we lost all the documents, we need to hire Burger King kids to falsify them for us. To the recovery service, actually, advertise on the web. Oh, did you lose the note? We can provide one for you. The note is what the home buyer signs, promising to make the payments. Whoops, we lost all those. That's okay. Advertise online. We create those for you. Anyway, and you no longer hold the mortgages, you securitize them and sell them to pension funds. Okay? Here is what a mortgage transaction looked like in Jimmy Stewart thrift. Looks kind of complicated. We don't need to go through it because you can compare it to, this is a new mortgage. This is the step of one mortgage. And it's not uncommon. This is what it looks like today. This is a much more efficient model, supposedly, according to Wall Street. Okay, why? The model was flawed from the very beginning. It could not have been profitable. Securitization had no possibility of ever being a profitable way to make home mortgage loans. The payments never could have covered all the costs. I already listed all the people whose hands are in the pie. All of those people get paid, almost all of them get paid before the first mortgage payment is ever made. It's all taken right off the top in fees. Okay? That's why the mortgages had to be for 120% of the value of the house, which already was inflated, because they had to be paid first. So they're paid right out of the home mortgage loan. The complexity was necessary to hide the accounting fraud. So this is Bill Black's piece of the story. Everyone was rewarded by throughput, not by the quality of the mortgages. It didn't matter whether the person would ever make a single mortgage payment. And actually, the first clue we had in January and February 2007, we started getting reports on defaults on the very first mortgage payment due. People had just bought a new house and missed their first payment, okay, in 2007. Those are skyrocketing. Obviously, this is fraud, okay? The home buyers couldn't even make the first payment. The beauty of Xeno, the house always wins. Bill Black always says, fraud is the most profitable thing there is. It's always a sure thing. Fraud is a sure thing until you get caught. But until you get caught, fraud is the most profitable business there is. We had $10 trillion worth of homes, tens of trillions of dollars of bets were made
mostly against the homeowners. Okay? Most of the bets are that the homeowners will not be able to make the payments, and that is how the financial sector is going to win. So foreclosure was inevitable. You could almost even argue that it was a desired outcome. You bet on the failure of the households, you take the houses away, you resell them, you make a new mortgage, and you get to start the whole thing all over again. Okay? So it actually was beneficial that the homeowners couldn't make the payments. You would end up concentrating ownership of the houses back at the banks, who could sell them and reboot the whole thing. I won't go through how that is like the 1929 investment trust. But if you want to understand this crisis, read John Kenneth Galbraith's book, The Great Crash, which is on 1929, because everything that he describes in that book is what happened up to 2007 in the United States. And I always say, you don't even need to change the names of the financial institutions involved in the 1929 crash. He has a chapter entitled Goldman Sachs. You don't even need to change that. You can read what Goldman Sachs did in 1929 and read what they did in 2004 to 2007. Wow, it's exactly the same. So, like Shrek's onion, every link, there are lots of links again, appraisers, brokers, lenders, MERS, securitizers, trusts, accounting firms, ratings agencies, and the servicers, every link is fraudulent. It has to be fraudulent. If you've got a broker who's making a mortgage loan to a home buyer and he knows the home buyer cannot make the payments, okay, cannot live up to the terms of the mortgage, everything else has to be fraud. There is no way that you can securitize that mortgage. It has to be a fraudulent securitization. And finally, when you get to the end, there is no way the foreclosure can be legal either. So every single step in the chain has to be fraudulent. You had appraisers who signed off on overvalued real estate. You had mortgage brokers giving mortgages they knew the borrowers could not repay. You had the mortgage lenders giving those loans and then selling the mortgages on to the investment banks, which securitized them, and then did reps and warranties saying, oh yes, we made very good mortgages. The mortgages standing behind the security, these are all really high quality mortgages. Absolutely false, known to be false. Then they, and on and on and on, ratings agencies had to verify that the securities were AAA, and on and on and on. Now, in the beginning, a lot of people were saying, well, yeah, but the fraud was on the part of the home buyers, right? These inner city unemployed people getting home mortgages, boy, they just duped the banks. They're just so much smarter than bankers. The banks didn't know what they were getting into, right? Letting people buy $500,000 homes on Venice Beach or something who had no job. Boy, the banks just got completely duped by these really brilliant, unemployed, uneducated people. No, that did exist. The best estimates are about 20% of the fraud was on the part of the borrowers. There really were home flippers. There were people buying 10, 20 homes, planning to flip them, and there is no doubt that happened. 80% of the fraud was on the part of the lenders. The Fed recognized that fraud had greatly increased. You can go back and read the Fed transcripts from the FOMC meetings. They discussed this in 2000. Already in 2000, it was apparent that fraud was increasing in home real estate. The FBI warned in 2004, there's an epidemic of fraud in the mortgage industry. Things were just barely getting started in 2004. The worst abuses began in 2004. So it only got worse and worse and worse and worse. And Washington refused to do anything about it. I know a lot of people say, well, the Fed couldn't do it. That's absolutely false. The Fed had complete authority to intervene anywhere a mortgage was made. Okay? It didn't matter whether it was a member bank or these mortgage lenders. All right. Then we had the crash. We've had no criminal prosecutions of top management. If you go back to the thrift crisis, 1,000 top management from the thrifts went to prison, 1,000. If you go back to the Great Depression, the Pecora Commission went after the top banks and prosecuted their top management. This time around, zero. No one is being prosecuted. Bernie Madoff and so on, but they are not top management of Goldman Sachs and Citigroup and Bank of America, where all this stuff was done. The bailout, you remember when Hank Paulson went to Congress, he wrote a three-page justification for, give me $800 billion, here's three pages, or I'll blow my brains out. And Congress said, forget it, we're not giving you the money. They came back with a 1,000-page document, and he got $800 billion. We got the stimulus package, so this is actual Treasury spending, that was $800 billion spread over 2 years. So we got about $400 billion. It helped the economy, but it's not nearly enough, given that we had lost about 4.5% of GDP. And then finally, the Fed took over. And the Fed's bailout through November was $29 trillion. That is what it costs to bail out Wall Street. $29 trillion so far, and counting. That was through November. What are they doing? They're trying to restore money manager capitalism. We're not gonna prosecute these guys, we're gonna bail them out, and we're gonna let them continue doing what they did before. Here is the Fed's balance sheet, the asset side. You can see this early peak, and you see lots of different colors, and you see an alphabet soup over here on the left-hand side. These were the special facilities created by the Fed to rescue financial institutions. In the paper that Philippe had, maybe some of you got those, I go through some of this, and then if you go to the Levy Institute, you can see one of my grad students, Andy Felkerson, spells all of this out, how we get the number $29 trillion through these various facilities. Now, there are different ways to measure the amount of intervention by the Fed to rescue the financial sector. One way is you could look at the peak outstanding amount lent and spent by the Fed at a point in time. And that's sort of what a balance sheet does. So a balance sheet is showing you a point in time. How much effort did it take? If you add up all of the facilities that were created, the maximum was about $1.5 trillion. So on a given day, the maximum spent and lent by the Fed was $1.5 trillion. The other way to measure it is you take every facility and every dollar lent or spent by the Fed in that facility and add up over time. That gives you a cumulative measure, okay? And that is the one that gets you to the $29 trillion. We were the first people to ever do this, okay? So we made headlines, and then we got a lot of criticism for it. Oh, you don't know the difference between the stock and flow. No, we know the difference between the stock and flow. The point is, look how long the crisis goes on. Look at the Fed's balance sheet in 08, okay? Less than a trillion. It goes up to more than 2 trillion, and it has to stay that high for this long, okay? That's because the financial system was not resolved, okay? So it continues to require intervention by the Fed. Our $2.9 trillion does not include QE. Okay, if we added QE and quantitative easing, if we added that into it, it would be a much bigger number than $29 trillion. Because now the Fed has closed down almost all of its special facilities, so they're not adding to our numbers. But look at how much trashy mortgage-backed securities the Fed has had to buy off the balance sheets of banks. Okay, it's a huge amount. In the second phase of QE, the Fed bought a lot of treasuries. I don't think that has any impact on the economy. It's not very important. these facilities, I don't know if any of you read Matt Taibbi at Rolling Stone. He had a hilarious but also shocking article, The Real Housewives of Wall Street. The Fed was lending near zero interest rates to the housewives of Wall Street to go buy mortgage-backed securities and other kinds of troubled financial assets in non-recourse loans. If the assets go bad, hey, the housewives don't have to repay the Fed. The Fed takes all the risk. Okay? That's the kinds of stuff that the Fed was doing. A lot of these facilities are very questionable in terms of legality. Okay? The Fed does not have the authorization to lend to housewives to go out to buy troubled assets. That is not permitted in the Federal Reserve Act. So there's a lot of question about how much of this stuff was illegal. It also was highly concentrated in the in a handful of huge financial institutions. A lot of these are foreign financial institutions. And a lot of the money also, not included in this chart, went to foreign central banks. Not necessarily illegal, but maybe not something Americans want their central bank to be doing, to helping bail out Credit Suisse, for example. Okay, finally, if you look at what you sort of expect a central bank to do in a financial crisis, they should lend short-term. Walter Bagehot had this idea. You lend short-term at a penalty interest rate against good collateral. Every central bank should do that in a financial crisis, okay? Expand it a bit and say, well, maybe the collateral doesn't have to be all that good, and maybe we'll lend it near zero because things are really bad. Well, that accounts for about 20% of what the Fed did. 80% of that doesn't fit this at all, okay? And so that is the really questionable stuff. We call it unconventional. About $24 trillion of the bailout is questionable whether the Fed should have done. Okay, I'll skip over a lot of this stuff. The projection was that by the end of 2012, 13 million Americans will have lost their home through foreclosure. Virtually all of these foreclosures are illegal. The banks do not have the documents. They do not have the standing to foreclose. Foreclosing on a house is not like repossessing a car. You miss some payments on your car loan, the holder of your paper can take the car. Okay, that's all they need. You miss some payments, they take the car. Houses are much more protected than that. Not only do they have to have your IOU, where you said, I promise to pay you, they have to have a title to your house. And the banks that are foreclosing do not have the titles. They lost them, they shredded them. They're gone in almost all cases. They cannot produce the titles. That's why they hire the Burger King kids to produce fake titles. Okay, so this is going on. That means that there's lots of felonies being committed in courts where you're presenting forged documents and lawyers are attesting to them, and vice presidents of banks are appearing out of nowhere. Often these are Burger King kids. They're deputized vice presidents of Chase Manhattan to show up in court and say, oh yeah, I checked all this stuff and everything's fine here. Finally, the home ownership rates are back to where they were before the boom began. And all of those homes that are being foreclosed on are being packaged and sold to hedge fund managers. And now to the GSEs. Are buying up huge blocks of foreclosed homes and renting them back to the homeowners that they just threw out. Anyway, it's concentrating wealth at the very top. I think, you know, that I wrote a paper on this in 2005. That is what the ownership society was all about. It was all about moving all of the ownership to the true owners, which is the top 1%. And this foreclosure process is going to complete that. Where are we gonna go? Very quick. Euroland is toast. We can talk about that in Q&E. I used to think that it would be the failure of some Euro bank that is gonna set off another global financial crisis, but I'm coming around to the view it's probably going to be the U.S. again that sets it off, probably not a European bank. It could be a European country that could set it off, a default by Italy or Spain, which are big enough to that they probably can't be sorted out by Germany and the ECB. In any case, I think we're going to have another global financial crisis. And this time around, instead of bailing them out, we should use Keynes's method, euthanasia of the rentier, that is radical euthanasia. Let the big banks fail this time and resolve them. That's what we need to do. The problem with that is that the managed money is also going to fail, okay, in two ways. One, a lot of the assets they're holding are no good because the banks pushed that toxic waste onto their balance sheets. But second, they also have stocks in all of these big banks. If the big banks go bankrupt, the pension funds will be hit really hard. So we're going to have to decide which of the managed money funds do we save. Pension funds, it makes sense to save those, and we have the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, which is sort of like an FDIC, not as generous, that stands behind pension funds. So we already are somewhat committed to bailing them out. Sovereign wealth funds, should we bail out Saudi Arabia's wealthy families? I don't know, maybe not. Mutual funds, possibly, we'll have to see. The good news about Dodd-Frank is a lot of the stuff that was done last time around is now illegal. Last time we did bail out the money market mutual funds. That is now not permitted in Dodd-Frank. However, where there's a will, there's a way. They might find a way to bail them out again, but hopefully not. Letting them fail in a way is a good thing because that is the simplification of the financial system that I was talking about. You get rid of the debt. If you get rid of the assets, you also get rid of the debt. So we can start again with very little private sector debt, a massive government debt. The good thing about running trillion-dollar budget deficits now is we're sending a lot of safe government bonds out into the financial sector. So we'll have a more robust financial system, hopefully this time constrained with new laws, new deal type laws, and supervision of the banks. Getting the banks to return to underwriting, that is actually assessing whether people are credit worthy enough to get a loan, and then holding the loans to maturity, that gives the right incentives to the banks. And finally, replacing financialization with another new deal, with growing wages, with full employment, and with consumption financed out of income rather than out of debt, and focusing on domestic consumption rather than trying to double exports, which is unfortunately President Obama's plan to get us out of this problem. We're going to double exports. That doesn't help Americans. What we need to do is increase domestic consumption, but not financed out of debt this time. I'm done, and we can do Q&A. And if you want, there are two blog sites there where you can go to read a lot of stuff.
Please turn up.
I have a quick question. First and foremost, I'd like to thank you, Professor Wright, for coming here to speak with us, just because a lot of us have read a lot of your material, and it's really great to have you on campus. I have a quick question regarding a paper that Jan Kregel wrote. I'm sure you're familiar with it. It's about financial reform. And I know I've read some of your papers where you kind of follow the Minskyan road of promoting smaller, more simple banks, because economies of scale are achieved at a relatively small level for financial institutions. But I thought it was interesting that Craigle made the point that the capital markets have developed to such a degree that it'd be impossible to return to a Glass-Steagall type system where commercial banks provide financing and investment banks provide funding. What do you think about that? I don't know if it's directly, if it doesn't agree with what your prescription would be or how it would fit in maintaining the commercial paper system, for example, and how, because that really contributed to a lot of the instability that we saw in the financial crisis. So just some of your thoughts on that.
First, it's true that you don't have to have the separation. You can have small banks that do both activities. And back, I think in the early 90s, several of us, including Minsky, worked on community development banking proposals. And even when we had Glass-Steagall, we were arguing that Glass-Steagall shouldn't apply to these banks. They should be able to offer a full range of services. But these were still going to be small banks. They served their community. No branching, so they could not grow to become a national bank. So I think that you can eliminate the separation without necessarily going to big banks, okay? I can't speak for Craigle. I think that his views are changing a little bit. I haven't heard him talk about this point recently, but I was just in Brazil with him. And he was arguing now that securitization was a huge mistake, that we just shouldn't allow it at all. And that is a big part of what investment banks were doing. So I would just say I'm not convinced by the argument that we need big investment banks. If you go back to 1999, which isn't that far ago, long ago, investment banks were still small. The reason they got big is because they went public. So they were partnerships. And they were conservative in their management and in terms of the kinds of financing that they would do and engage in. The incentives were aligned. They had a long-term view of what they were doing. In 1999, they all went public. And they had a separation of management and ownership of the institutions. And they all started hiring people like Henry Paulson and Bob Rubin to run the business. And these guys were rewarded with ownership shares that I already talked about. And they started greatly reducing the time horizon of investment banking, where relationships, good relationships with your customers no longer matter. It's said that when Goldman Sachs has a customer come in that wants financing for some activity, that Goldman Sachs immediately puts together two teams. One team is to negotiate the worst possible terms they can get the customer to agree to. And the other team starts figuring out how they're going to bet on the customer failing. And you think that I'm joking, but all you have to do is read about these deals that Goldman Sachs did with people like John Paulson, where he brings in a hedge fund, where Goldman Sachs brings in a hedge fund manager and says, hey, we're going to let you pick the very worst mortgages to put into the security. Then we're going to sell CDOs based on the security, so it's a derivative of the derivative. We're going to sell these CDOs to our own customers, and both you and us are going to bet that those mortgages go bad. Okay? So we get the fee income up front. Then when the mortgages go bad, Goldman Sachs' own customers lose, but Goldman Sachs wins on the CDSs. Okay? This is what they're doing. Okay, it is because, not necessarily because they're big, but because their whole incentive structure changed. So anyway,
It's not quite a direct answer because I'm not sure that I know the answer to this.
Actually, just if I can ask a quick follow-up question. One thing that the big investment banks do well is proprietary trade, and they were effectively functioning as large hedge funds following up to the financial crisis. So I'm not really familiar, unfortunately, with the Dodd-Frank regulations. I know that they've qualified them a lot to the point where they're pretty much impotent on proprietary trading. Do you have any particular views on the utility, you know, so to speak, of those actions, or do they serve any economic purpose rather than to just generate, you know, profits for investment banks?
Well, unfortunately, it's another way to bet against your customers, front running and stuff like that. So I think that it leads to incentive problems with your customers. Dodd-Frank, I haven't studied it either in detail, but it seems to have so many loopholes that it's not going to be very effective. So I think that getting proprietary trading out of these banks is a good idea, but Dodd-Frank is probably not going to do it.
Debt is a stock variable and income is a flow variable. The servicing cost of debt is the lowest since 1984 according to the household financial obligation ratio. Is it more important to compare the servicing costs of debt rather than the actual debt to income? Or why do we compare debt to income when debt is going to be paid off with income flows over the next 20 to 30 years?
Yeah, the debt service ratio, you're right, doesn't necessarily follow the debt ratio, although in the run-up to the crisis, the debt service ratio was going up. And when that gets to about 14%, historically, you can look back, when it gets to about 14%, we get a financial crisis. Now, it's true that the interest rates are extremely low, and whoever could refinance their home mortgage is making out very well. But it's pretty hard to refinance your mortgage. If you're one of those people that took out a mortgage around 2006, you probably cannot do that. You vastly overpaid for your house, you're probably vastly underwater, and you probably were not a great borrower even in 2006. And now we're in an economy that lost 12 million jobs, and your own position might be questionable. You might have had cut back in hours at least. Maybe a member of your family lost a job. So it's very hard for people to take advantage of the low interest rates. A lot of people are locked into high rates that they can't get out of. They can't renegotiate and they can't refinance. One of the reasons they can't renegotiate is no bank holds their mortgage. So they've all been securitized. So that makes it extremely hard to solve this mortgage problem. Just finally, the other side of the coin of extremely low rates, of course, is that your financial assets are not earning you much income. Japan had essentially zero interest rates for 20 years, and we see what happened to their economy. They stagnated. On some conditions, raising interest rates actually can help stimulate your economy because it increases interest income. Especially if we run trillion-dollar budget deficits for five more years, we're going to have so much government debt out there in the private sector that raising rates might actually increase people's income flows and be beneficial for the economy. That's what looked to be happening in Japan, which had started finally raising their interest rates right before the financial crisis. Of course, with the crisis, then they went back to zero rate policy. So I agree with you. The problem is, if you can't refinance, you're still stuck with high rates. And many people who were trying to live on interest rates are now hit with the low rates. But we need to look at both measures, the debt ratio and the debt service ratio. I agree with that.
By letting the banks, big banks, fail next time around, are we truly capable of emerging as a what Minsky would call a robust economy? And if so, what would you call this stage of capitalism?
Remember,
On the first slide, I didn't talk about it, but Minsky always said we've got 57 varieties, so it's going to be very hard to know where we're going to go after this one. I would like us to return to something like the managerial welfare state capitalism. I don't like that term, it's Minsky's term. New Deal capitalism. But it has to be 2.0. We can't go back and do exactly the same thing. The Glass-Steagall Act, it wouldn't make sense to just adopt exactly the same policies that we adopted in the 30s. Yes, the world changed tremendously. So we can't do that. We need to go forward. And we need to work now, before the thing hits, to have some stuff off the shelf. We can pull these down and say, this is what we need to do. And that's what Craigle is doing with a Ford grant, trying to figure out what we're going to replace the financial system with. I think that there is a huge amount of terror out there about what are we going to do with, we've got $2 trillion banks each, right? And then we've got some that are close to $1 trillion. So if we take the dirty dozen, 12 biggest banks, that's where almost all the problems are. Small local banks are in trouble only because of the economy. They didn't do any of the stuff that I'm talking about. Okay. Well, except for the seconds. They did a lot of home equity loans. Okay, but they didn't do any of the other stuff. So it's all concentrated in the top 12. And then it's really concentrated in the top 6. So when I talk about banks owing banks, layering debt on debt on debt, that's the top 6 banks. Credit default swaps, it's the top 6 banks. Okay, on and on and on. The riskiest stuff is in their hands. And who do they owe? Each other. So we've got a $2 trillion bank that owes a $2 trillion bank. We net them, they net to about zero. They don't matter much, actually. They're huge. To bail them out costs a huge amount of money, as I showed, about $29 trillion. Okay. But they don't owe that much to others. Goldman Sachs now has a bank charter. It's a deposit bank. It doesn't have any deposits. Okay? Bank of America, if current trends continue, will not be a deposit bank. Everybody is pulling out. Okay? Occupy Wall Street. So this is going on. They are being downsized by households, pulling their funds out. That makes it much easier to close it down. So I don't actually think it's that hard. In 2008, if we had taken the top 6 banks on a Friday, close them down, I don't mean resolve them on Friday, I mean physically lock the doors, take the management out, promote middle management, bring the government supervisors in, start going through the books, find the fraud, start the prosecution. On Monday, you open them up, the ATM machine works, they got some tellers there, they've got the middle management promoted up, they've got tons of government supervisors in there to watch them. You say, no more loans, and you can't sell any assets. Okay? Because we don't want any more fraud. You put cease and desist order on almost everything they do, except depositors can come in, withdraw, they can write checks, but nothing new. Then you start finding out who owes who. Remember, Geithner found out that AIG owed Goldman Sachs and a handful of other banks. The whole AIG bailout was to bail out those banks, give them 100 cents on the dollar on very risky bets they had taken with AIG. That's what we did last time. But they could just as well have said, okay, we're going to take all this stuff and net it out, and you guys are going to have to take the loss. And if you can't survive the loss, we're going to resolve you. Okay, we're going to break you up into little pieces and sell the pieces off. They could have done that back then. And you don't have to take my word for it, because Bill Black, who did this with the thrifts, knows how to do it, and he can spell out exactly how you start. First, you just stop any new activity, you fire all top management, and then you start figuring out how you're going to resolve the institutions. It's not that hard. Bank resolutions are done all the time, And the 2 trillion number is a very misleading number.
Just a word.
About that, when we resolved the thrifts, though, we waited for the collapse and then resolved them all together in some sense. And when you're talking about these 6 banks, wouldn't you have to not just take over one of them, but essentially take over all 6 simultaneously so that this actually netted out?
Absolutely. That Friday, you hit all 6. Yes, that's true. Although they were resolving thrifts for many years before they finally set up the resolution trust and said, hold it, we got to do the whole thing, right? So they were doing a piecemeal as they went along with no plan until finally, you know, to Bush Sr.'s credit, he pushed this through. And I was very skeptical at the time. I was watching this go on, knowing that 2 of Bush's sons were heavily involved in thrift failures. I didn't believe that this resolution was going to be good. The pessimists were saying that this is going to cost $1 trillion. In the end, it cost $200 billion to resolve that mess. So it wasn't as bad as we thought, and I think this one won't be either, if we did it that way.
I just had a question on special purpose vehicles. We talk a lot about that in Professor Resende's class. And we've seen, like, over time how they've been used as, like, as Bill Lack would say, like, tools for accounting fraud and control fraud. And you spoke in your paper that kind of went along with this talk about how even the New York Fed used SPVs in the process of bailing out. Is there, I guess, a good way to use an SPV not committing fraud or, like, Enron hiding that? Is there even a good positive use for one of them? And why haven't they been done away with that? I just feel like it's so absurd that these are... just no one works there. They're just legal documents where people can just hide debt, hide credit risk through synthetic securitization, funded securitization. I just wondered what your thoughts were on that.
Yeah, it is ironic that the New York Fed, after watching what all the banks did with SPVs, said, oh, let's create some SPVs. The reason they did it was to get around the Federal Reserve Act. Federal Reserve Act, like I said, says you can only lend to a troubled bank. That's the only thing the Fed can lend to. What the Fed wanted to do, though, was to lend to housewives so they could buy troubled assets, okay? And so they created SPVs. The Fed would then lend to an SPV, which would then lend to housewives. The Fed can't lend to SPVs, though, either, okay? Because the SPV is not troubled. It doesn't have any assets at all until it starts buying them after the Fed lends to them. So the whole thing was to get around the law. But yes, why did the banks use these? Originally, it was to get around capital requirements. So off-balance sheet operations are old. I wrote about them in my dissertation a long time ago. And they were huge, what we knew of. They were huge, just what we knew, and there probably was tons of stuff we didn't know about. So it was a way to get stuff off the balance sheet so they didn't have to hold capital against it. So all the so-called hedging, interest rate hedging, foreign exchange hedging, was all off balance sheet so that they didn't have to record the risk, because they really weren't hedging, they were betting. They were placing bets on interest rate or exchange rate movements. So the answer is no bank should be permitted to have anything off balance sheet. Off balance sheet should just be absolutely illegal. No protected financial institution that has access to the Fed or the Treasury, FDIC, should be allowed to do anything off their balance sheet. That would be, I think, the solution.
Hi, I've got 2 questions. First, you've begun to see indications that the U.S. economy is moving in the correct direction, and I was wondering if you could give a brief forecast of what you see to come, and also, as households begin to pay off the debt that they accumulated over the past several years, do you see any new strategies these big banks may use to incentivize a new round of borrowing?
Okay. The economy, I'm still very pessimistic, but I have to admit I have friends I respect a lot, like Frank Veneroso, who has come around. He thinks we are in a sustainable recovery. And usually Frank is the most pessimistic, bearish person you'll ever come across. So
I don't know. I haven't changed my mind yet. I can't see it happening, and the reason is because of the real estate sector. If you look at past real estate busts, they take 10 years to turn around. And those always were regional, usually Texas, Florida, California. So they've had a number of real estate busts. It generally takes about 10 years for it to turn around. And that was in the context of the national economy growing without any real estate problems. This time, most parts of the country are in trouble. Okay, we have a deep recession, but also we have a general real estate bust all over the country. I don't see how we're going to pull the real estate sector out of this. The real estate sector is extremely important to households. So they have trouble making their mortgage payments, but households rely on their homes to send their kids to college. They rely on the homes to retire. They can sell the home, buy something smaller. And you can't sell your house now in large parts of the country. You can't borrow against your house. So I think that this is a really depressing influence, something we haven't seen since the 1930s. Nothing since comes close to what we have now in the real estate sector. And it's made much worse by the securitization, as I was saying earlier. Even if you had a good job, good income, good credit risk, you can't get better terms on your mortgage unless the security holders will agree to it. So that's the way the securitizations were written. It's very hard to renegotiate the mortgages. Americans typically move once every 7 years. Okay, so we've been in this thing since home prices peaked in 2006. So we're almost at 7 years. Almost all Americans should have moved by now, but they can't. Okay, so they're stuck with houses, their job may be in another city, they can't sell the old house. So we've got just a mess with the real estate sector. So I don't see us recovering. We get little bits of good news, but again, read John Kenneth Galbraith's The Great Crash, because he talks about the Harvard Economics Club. I don't remember if that's the actual name of it. But the top economists in America at Harvard would get together every year and see recovery coming. And they would issue a pronouncement that, yes, we're in a sustainable recovery, now everything's going to be all right. And finally, they just disbanded the group because they got it wrong every year. It always looked like recovery all through the 1930s. Okay, so it doesn't surprise me that we get pieces of good news. You expect that. This is a huge economy, and data's confusing, and it gets revised. And I don't think that we're coming out. On the getting the household sector to borrow, you know, borrowing, what I talked about in the talk was the Rick Wolf argument, that the borrowing was out of necessity. So wages aren't growing, but your aspirations are. Okay, there's all sorts of nice new products out, right? Everybody wants the new iPad, whatever number it is. So you're willing to borrow to get it, okay, because your income is not going up. But there something has happened in all the English-speaking nations that consumers are much more willing to borrow than other nations. I mean, the picture I showed you here of the private sector deficits and the debt explosion, it happened in every English-speaking nation. There's something going on. It's cultural. Yes, maybe it's advertising, but there is something going on. So I wouldn't say it won't happen. That is another consumer debt-fueled bubble. It seems much less likely after what we've gone through, but it could happen. It could happen again.
In the way that the Great Depression shook up mainstream economics and changed the way that we thought about economics, do you think that this most recent crash will change how economics is taught or just how we understand it in general?
Well, it better. When the crisis occurred, a lot of us were pretty optimistic. I was on a panel with Jamie Galbraith, and it was on this, and probably it was 2009. And we said, well, okay, good. We don't have to teach the mainstream stuff anymore. No one's going to be teaching that. Everyone realized, you know, Chicago just completely got it wrong, and we're going to move on. Obviously, that was overly optimistic. I was then invited to University of Chicago. I was on a panel with these guys, and they were all saying, oh, yeah, see, we got it right. And I mean, these were, FAMA was on the panel. Oh, yeah, efficient markets hypothesis. We had it exactly right. So it doesn't matter what happens, right? You could, economics, it's very open. You can explain almost anything, right? So I'm less pessimistic now that the mainstream, anyway, is going to change much of what they teach. If we collapse again, maybe there's a slightly greater chance. But I can just tell you what my own strategy has been. I've reduced the amount of time I spend on that stuff. And I'm just hoping for the best.
Again, thanks for coming here, sir. This question is to ask for an elaboration on something you mentioned in one of your recent blog posts on Economic Perspectives, which, by the way, is a phenomenal blog. You and Mr. Black are phenomenal writers. You mentioned that there's never a good reason for a nation to surrender its monetary sovereignty. I'm wondering if that's as absolute as you say, because Iceland is even now apparently making noises or talking about reverting to the Canadian kroner. Just wondering.
Blanket statements are always, you know, in part they're to grab attention, and they could be a mistake. But no, I don't see any reason to give up sovereignty. I think it's extremely small nations may not be a good idea. But if you've decided you're going to be a nation, then you should have your own currency. So I don't see a good reason not to have your own sovereign currency. It gives you domestic fiscal and monetary policy space. And if you don't want those, why do you want to be a separate nation? So it's what gives you the power to do what you want to do in your nation. And if you don't want that, why not just join some other country? You will have a much better chance if you're a member of the country while using their currency than if you use their currency and you're not a member. The reason is because if you're not a member of the country, when things go bad, which they probably will, they don't feel any compunction to help you out. So Argentina tried this. Argentina decided, let's abandon our currency, we'll use a currency board. Essentially, it's like adopting the dollar. And when they got in trouble, what did America do for them? Nothing. They're not a member of the country. They adopted the dollar. When they got in trouble, we let them go. So I think that that's the problem. It's very likely you're going to get into a deficit problem. The three financial balances apply to every country. And unless you happen to be Singapore, or today China, but that won't last very long, that can rely on exports so that you're getting the positive account on the from your exports, then you must have a budget deficit or your private sector can't save. Okay? Private sectors want to save and probably need to save. So it's completely rational for the private sector to want to run a budget surplus. That means you have to run a budget deficit unless you can count on positive exports. So you're going to have a budget deficit. That should be the normal expectation of any country, with the exception of an export nation. Okay? If you're going to have a budget deficit, you need your own currency. Argentina's budget deficit never went above 3% of GDP. Argentina always met the Maastricht criteria. And they had a deficit crisis anyway. The markets shut them down because they thought 3% is too big. Okay, so that's the problem. So that's why I say you cannot give up your currency if you want to be a separate nation. Now, you unite, if Argentina had become the 51st state of the United States, okay, we allow individual states to run deficits, and we get a fiscal transfer from the national government to the deficit state. That's how we solve the problem. But you're not going to get a significant fiscal transfer if you're not a member of the nation.
Okay, so part of this we touched on already, but I wanted to ask you a question about the Basel III requirements. I've been looking at the Basel requirements throughout the semester, and as you mentioned, Basel I was not that effective in reducing risk and kind of even promoted off-balance sheet transactions and securitization. And Basel III is supposed to be stricter, adding the leverage restrictions and liquidity standards. But I read some articles from some of your colleagues stating that it's not going to be that effective and it's flawed in many ways. I wanted to ask you what you thought and how would you, like, ideally change it, if at all. I mean, I know you expressed your opinion that securitization should be banned altogether, but in the near term, if that's not possible, what do you think should be done?
Okay. So I haven't read the Basel III. I did study Basel II. I wrote a paper, I think, in 2005 on Basel II, sort of from a Minskyan perspective. So I can just give a general answer. The problem is that the attitude of Basel is that we can find a magic number that is a capital ratio that will make a bank safe. And the answer to that is no, you cannot. The higher the capital ratio, the lower the return on equity. And so you're incentivizing them to buy the riskiest assets that they can. So what Basel II does in response to that is it has risk-weighted capital, but still you have the incentive to get the highest risk within the risk weighting, and that's why you don't buy German government debt, you buy Greek government debt. Same risk weighting, but Greek debt pays more. So that's exactly what they did. So you will always have the gaming this way, okay? And the truth is that if you're gonna use capital to make a bank safe, you probably need a capital ratio of 80%, okay? Maybe 50%. But 10% is never gonna make a bank safe. That means effectively they're leveraging 10 to 1. Okay? They got a dollar of their own for $10 of assets. That doesn't make a bank safe. They can easily lose that. So if you're gonna use capital, you need extremely high capital ratios. And the problem with that is that banks will never compete with the shadow banks, okay? So I think the answer is keep the capital ratios lower. What exactly the number is, I don't know. There is no magic number. But you have to supervise the asset side, and that's what they don't want to do. Okay, the regulators, whether the Fed or the people writing Basel, they don't want to regulate the asset side. You've got to regulate it, you've got to supervise them. And the idea that you can substitute a capital ratio for that, and then maybe external rating agencies, which can be bought, we know, that will substitute for actually watching what they do, just is not going to be a good substitute. And then, you know, finally, it goes back to bigness. So the big institutions, we heard when after the crisis hit, the CEOs of the big institutions said, well, you can't expect us to know what's going on in our institutions. They're too big. They're too big for us to manage. They're also, of course, too big to supervise and too big to regulate. They're too complex. I don't remember which one of the top banks, the top CEO admitted he didn't know what a credit default swap was. Okay, he's managing this institution. That there are $70 trillion worth of credit default swaps out there, and they're held by the top six banks, so they've each got trillions and trillions. And the top CEO, I didn't know what a credit default swap was until the crisis hit. Okay? Yeah, that's the problem. The institutions are too big, they're too complex. And the idea that they're going to use their own internal risk models, and then the credit ratings agencies are going to substitute for managing and supervising them is just crazy. It's not going to work.
Well, we know that.
Yeah. If you ever get to Ken Rogoff, just ask, have you figured out what a credit default swap is yet?
I just have a few notes before you finish. I'd like to thank the Department of Economics, the Public Policies Program, the Department of Political Science, the Office of the Provost, and the Hobart Dean's Office, and the William Smith Dean's Office, and in particular to Jean Salon and Cindy Warren for helping putting this event together. Thank you so much, and I'd like to thank thanks to Professor Ray for coming to HWS and for your insightful lecture. As a student, it's always good to go back to my ears as students and just listen to what I have to say. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming.